Are we live on Facebook?
Yes.
Yes, yeah, doctor, we are live on Facebook now. Yeah. Of
Shall we go ahead and get started?
course, yeah. Dr. Ahmed Hassan, yes.
Dr. Ahmed. Unmute Dr. Ahmed.
My name is Ahmed Hassan. I'm the Dean of the Information Technology and Computer Science School in Nile University. I will host this meeting with my colleague, Dr. Mustafa Al-Attar, who is leading the Artificial Intelligence Program in Nile University. First, let us have Dr. Tariq Khalil, the President of Nile University, to welcome you and the speaker.
Thank you, Dr. Ahmed. Thank you very much for hosting this seminar. I'd like to welcome Professor Vincenzo Piuri for this kind acceptance of our invitation to be our speaker tonight. I am delighted that he is with us, and I am indeed honored that we have such a distinguished scholar that has been in the business of computer engineering and artificial intelligence for many years. I know that Dr. Ahmed Hassan will present Professor Plouri in a much more appropriate way, but I wanted to actually welcome all the attendees, welcome all the Board of Trustees members who are with us, the advisory board members, the honorable guests from the various institutions around Egypt and around the world, as a matter of fact. And indeed, it's a pleasure to have Professor Plouri with us, because artificial intelligence is extremely important, not only for us at Nile University, but worldwide. And we are indeed very much into this business because we want to be at the forefront of technology and artificial intelligence, and the part of the fourth industrial revolution and beyond is going to be the wave of the future. So I'm really very much keen on hearing Professor Plouri's comments and remarks. And I'm sure that everybody with us in here is also very eager to hear his points of view. And without any further ado, I would like to welcome all of you again and give the floor to Dr. Ahmed Hassan to present our speaker properly.
Thank you all. I'm very delighted to have Vin with us today. Vin is a full professor in computer engineering for many years. He is an IEEE fellow, distinguished scientist of SEM, with many other titles, many other associations with different organizations. He is currently the president of the IEEE Systems Council. In addition, he has a lot of publications, more than 400 plus publications, and he is the editor in chief for many publications in IEEE, transactions on software engineering, on network, and many others. Without having a lot of delay, Vin, you have the floor. Welcome to Egypt. You have a lot of fans coming from Ghana, United Arab Emirates, Saudi Arabia, from England, from the whole Region 8, IEEE. So please, you have the floor. We are waiting for a month now for your lecture and talk. Please proceed.
Thank you. Honorable officers, ladies and gentlemen, Masahu Alkahir. Good evening. It is really a great pleasure to be here with you this evening and talk about one of the areas in which I have been active for many, many years, the use of artificial intelligence for a variety of applications, in particular for to create intelligent systems for industrial and environmental applications. We are going to have a quick look how we can use these technologies in industrial and environmental applications, including also transportation and supply chains, which can be viewed from the application point of view as special cases of this type of problems. And in particular, we are going to see how we can use artificial intelligence to analyze the data from the sensors, to extract relevant knowledge, and to perform classification, clustering, in order to understand which is the status of the system and how we can manage and control the system itself. The ultimate goal is to provide enough information, enough knowledge to the decision makers so that they can take the most informed decision for increasing the quality and the productivity of the manufacturing plants to ensure safety and livability of the environment in which we live, as well as to ensure many services to the people, especially nowadays where we can have the use of these technologies for smart cities, which is very, very important for the future, especially of big cities. For industrial applications, we can use typically artificial intelligence in two main areas. The first one is managing the manufacturing process, acquire information about the status of the manufacturing process, of the various activities which are performed in manufacturing process, and choose which are the appropriate control point for having the best quality of the manufacturing process, which means to have the best quality of the production, the lowest energy as possible, the best use of the material, of the resources that we are needed during the entire manufacturing process. In addition, the second critical aspect is quality control. We can produce a huge amount of products, but more and more, if we want to be really competitive in the global market, we need actually to provide also high quality products. We need to ensure which is the quality of the product that we deliver, and we need actually to make sure that for each item that we produce, we can certify the quality of that item so that we can offer to the customers the best quality for each item. And we can associate to a specific quality level the best price that we can offer so that we can be really competitive on the market. It is important to point out that nowadays, there are many applications, industrial applications, in which we certify the quality, but typically this is done on a statistical basis. We pick some of the items in the manufacturing batch, we analyze the quality of these items, and then we assume that the quality of the entire batch is the same of the items that we have analyzed. On the other side, in many cases, in order to perform this analysis, we have to destroy the items. And as a consequence, we lose some of the production. In environmental applications, basically what we wanted to do is to observe, to monitor the environment in which we live in order to be sure about what is happening and to provide enough information to the decision makers in order to act properly, to preserve the environment, to detect possible critical situations for people, like with pollution or with natural phenomena, flooding or sliding in the mountains or any other possible critical situation like this. What we wanted to do is to have various tools in the environments which are able to collect enough information from which we can deduce the knowledge characterizing the events occurring in the specific environment. This type of technologies actually can be used also to address the needs of supply chain applications, where basically we need to control the quality of the various items that are moved around from the resource providers to the industry, creating the products to the final customers. But we need also to ensure that the entire chain has a good quality, is optimized to minimize the cost of the supply chain, and as a consequence, the cost of the goods that we are, or the services that we are providing. The same for transportation, more in general, not only for the supply chain, but for people as well. We can use these technologies also for monitoring what is happening, the behavior of the transportation, and collect the proper amount of knowledge, which is essential to manage properly these systems. How we can do this? Well, of course, we can do the observation manually, observing what is happening in the industrial manufacturing processes, in the environment, in the supply chain, in the transportation. But this is very boring in general, is very repetitive, and in some cases may be dangerous, especially when we need to collect information about possible critical situations which may impact the life, the safety, the health of people. And on the other side, a computer does not get tired in repeating continuously the same basic operations. As a consequence, what we can do is to introduce automatic monitoring and control systems in all these activities. We can collect the information, analyze the information, transform the basic data into knowledge, which is useful to the decision makers, or is useful automatically to the control system whenever we have to apply a control directly in the various applications I mentioned before. The behavior of this automatic approach, well, will be accurate, continuously accurate, the more accurate as possible, according to how we design and tune this system. Is repetitive without any problem, is standardized, the same quality is applied to every item, to every observation, and in general is non-invasive. We don't need to destroy the items that we are producing. We can collect information during the manufacturing process and associate to this information the quality directly of the item we are producing. So basically what we have here is an example for cutting a metal by using laser. What we can do is to use these technologies to observe the behavior of the laser beam and what is happening during the cutting to the metal, so that we can associate to this information the status, the operation of our system. In this specific case, just as an example, what we see with the laser is that we have a jet of sparkles, and the amplitude and the direction of the sparkles can be associated to the quality of the cutting. So looking to the feature, to the value of each feature, we can analyze the status of the system and deduce which is the quality of the operation we are performing. And the same in the various other applications I mentioned before. This is just one of the many examples that we can consider. So what we need to do to create this monitoring and control system? We needed to perform several operations on this data, and it has been shown that artificial intelligence can be very, very useful in supporting these operations with a flexible, adaptable approach, which is able to learn also from the real data, from the real cases that we are considering, without having to design a priori the desired behavior of the system, which in some cases may not be so easy to do. Or we can use also the natural language to describe the characteristic, the quality of what we are observing, how we want to manage the environment, so that it will be much easier, more natural, to describe what is happening in the environment. And this is why we can introduce the fuzzy logic. Or we can use the evolutionary computing as an optimization tool when we have many, many parameters to optimize, and the objective function contains many, many local and minima or maxima. So all of this, these are a few of the technologies that we can use with artificial intelligence. And then we have machine learning, pattern analysis. We have many others that can be used. And the goal is to create an intelligent adaptive system which is able to adjust its behavior during the operation, observing the real world operation. But we do not need actually to use only one technology to address the entire problem. Usually the systems are very complex. So in general, what we need to have the best solution is actually to put together both the traditional approach, algorithmic approaches, with the artificial intelligence, so that we can have, here is just an example, a comprehensive system in which one of the parts is addressed by a neural network, another by one of the algorithmic approaches, one of a traditional filter, one by using a fuzzy algorithm, and so on. The goal is to give a broader spectrum of techniques to the designer, so that we will have a higher degree of freedom. And this will allow to get a higher accuracy in general and a higher performance, since we are using exactly the best to address each part of the system. But the main problem is that actually we need to address all the various parts all together in order to have the best system. In the typically what we may be used to do is to consider the various separate aspects, and this may bring to a limited optimization and reusability and integrability. If we want really to get the highest quality solution, well, we need to consider all aspects together to have a comprehensive design methodology, and then split the entire specifications in parts so that we can address the various parts with the most appropriate solutions. But let's have a quick look to the various parts that we need to address, to the various operations that we need to perform in this type of system. We have, first of all, the need of acquiring the data from the environment, from the system, by and we can use a conventional algorithmic techniques for the sensor analysis and diagnosis, but we can use also artificial intelligence, especially for self-calibration or for very complex non-linearities or for error and fault detection in the sensor. Then we need to analyze the data, the signals that we are receiving from the sensors and possible visual sensors too. Signal preprocessing is important since we can enhance the quality of the signal themselves. We can remove errors which may be present in the signals or noise at least due to the fact that the natural sensors are generates anyway some noise in the output. Removing the noise is very useful, at least as much as possible, is very useful since this will allow to observe the data and work on the data in a much simpler way. If we need to analyze patterns, if we need to classify information about coming from, derived from the signal that we observed, if we need to do this having at the same time the errors, the real data signals that we are generated by the environment, and at the same time, the noise introduced in the signals, but the natural physical processes of occurring in the sensor, it will be much more complex since we needed to take into account both this type of phenomena. If we remove first the noise as much as possible, then learning the desired behavior may be easier. And as a consequence, we'll simplify the use of the artificial intelligence techniques. When we are dealing with artificial intelligence, we may not be really interested in all the fine details of the signals and images. We may be interested in some characteristics, relevant features that we observe in the signals. For example, the slope of the signal, the maximum value, all this, the general shape of the signal, since this may be related to the behavior of the physical process that we are observing. So this is why it's important to extract the features from the real data coming from the sensors. And this will reduce significantly the complexity of the subsequent operation, since we will not focus on the entire data set coming from the sensors, but we will focus on some specific characteristics of this data set. Neural and fuzzy techniques have been shown very, very effective to this purpose. But how many features? Which are the features that we need to extract? If we have a few features, obviously the complexity is low, but also the accuracy will be low, since we are collecting little information, little knowledge from the environment, from the process we are observing. So having many features will increase the complexity, but in general will not automatically increase the accuracy. If we have, for example, some features which are strictly related to each other by physical laws, the additional features will not increase the knowledge we have about the system. We just increase the complexity of the information we are managing. So what we need to do is actually to understand which are the relevant features. We need to select the relevant feature. And for this reason, there are many techniques, statistical based techniques or artificial intelligence based techniques, which have been shown very effective to this purpose. In some applications, it is more desirable to observe the situation, the status of the environment in a holistic way, in a comprehensive way. For example, if we need to manage the condition, the air conditioning in an environment, we need to consider at the same time the humidity and the temperature. Controlling only one may not be that effective. So merging the data coming from these two different sensors for temperature and humidity will allow to create the comfort feature representing the status of the environment. And as a consequence, we can take the most accurate decision by looking in an holistic way this data. Data fusion is therefore very important for this purpose, and artificial intelligence has been shown effective in this perspective. But we may need also to create virtual sensors by using these strategies. For example, if we need to support agriculture, to analyze the humidity on the soil in a geographical area, in a field or in a larger geographical area, or if we need to observe the status of forests, for example, if they are too dry and possible fire may start, we can actually put sensors, humidity sensors in the field. But this may be expensive. These sensors may be damaged by animals or by working in the field. We can use a completely different approach. We can use an image taken from the satellite about the humidity of the soil. Well, actually, not the humidity, but we can measure the amount of light, of the sunlight reflected by the ground, by the humidity which is in the ground. The higher is the humidity, the more the light will be reflected at a specific bandwidth related to the water which is in the soil. So measuring the amount of light reflected, we can deduce which is the amount of humidity which is in the soil. And as a consequence, we created a virtual sensor which give us the information we are interested in, not directly, but measuring something else which is related to that specific quantity. And also in this case, artificial intelligence has been shown very, very effective. Then the core of the operation of a monitoring and control system is actually classification, clustering, pattern recognition, since these are the characteristics, characteristic operation that we need to perform to classify the status of a manufacturing process, to classify the quality of a specific product, to classify the status of the environment, what is happening in the environment, and so on. Artificial intelligence, neural and fuzzy techniques have been shown very effective in order to perform a classification, both generating an integer output measuring the specific quality, or a floating point value as an index, as a continuous index for the quality itself, or for the control for the status of the environment. The last step is actually control. If we have a monitoring system, we need to understand the status of the environment we are observing, of the process we are observing. But if we have a control to be applied, if we want the environment to act as we wish, by adjusting some parameters which are acting on the environment itself, for example, for the manufacturing process or for the air conditioning and so on, we need to implement a control system. And in addition to the conventional PID techniques or more sophisticated approaches, neural-based and fuzzy-based techniques have been shown very, very effective in the literature and in the practice to create this type of system. The last operation is a system optimization. When we have a complex manufacturing system or a complex environment with many information coming from various sensors, we may need to tune the parameters of the model representing what we are observing. And evolutionary computation has been shown very effective in this perspective, especially when we have many, many local minima or maxima, and we have a significant number of parameters. In order to support all of these applications, we definitely need to use information and communication technologies, since we need to collect the data, and we need to bring the data, the information about the environment, about the physical processes that we are observing from the physical environment to a computing system, so where we have the algorithm, the strategies, the methodologies that are able to extract the knowledge and provide this view to the decision makers, to a control systems or to humans who may need to take decisions on the activities performed in the system. Internet of Things and cyber physical systems are nowadays typical models based on internet to create this infrastructure. The Internet of Things is a general purpose, is a global interconnection in which to which we attach the sensors, the actuators, the various devices that we are interested in. And then we bring with internet all information generated by these devices to the applications, which typically are in appropriate servers connected in the system. And in these servers, the applications are interacting with the users, are analyzing the data, are generating the control signals, which may be delivered back to the actuators in the field to achieve the desired control. In the case of Internet of Things, we have the general internet and the various devices, the various applications are connected together according to the specifications of the applications, but they are interacting in a shared way in the internet infrastructure. In the case of the cyber physical system, we have a similar structure, but the resources, the connections are completely dedicated to a specific application. I can have a physically dedicated connection and devices, or I can have virtual devices like in the software-defined network in which I can connect the various components in the network and I dedicate these components and the various connections in the network to that specific application, at least a part of the connection. And the other application will never be able to use this virtualized network. But basically the principle is the same between the Internet of Things and the cyber physical system. When we have collected the data, we need to store them and we need actually to be able to process this data, to extract the knowledge in order to provide the information to the control system or to the decision maker. Nowadays, the modern approach is not to have local servers unless there are other reasons, but typically what we try to do is to bring everything to the cloud so that in the cloud we can have as much resources are needed at the minimum possible cost. and we delegate the maintenance, the management of these resources to experts which are offering the storage and processing service according to what we really need. The problem is that if we are controlling an environment or a manufacturing process, we may have a huge amount of data which are flowing from the sensors up to the applications. And as a consequence, the bandwidth may not be supported by the actual connection that we may have. For these reasons, we may move the infrastructure to a different model. We can consider what is called nowadays the fog computing, in which we move a part of the storage, a part of the computation from the cloud down in the local environment. Or if the bandwidth is really, really demanding, we may need to bring even downer the computation and the storage to the edge of the system with the edge computing model. In this case, we will do a significant part of pre-processing of the data nearer to the sensor as possible, so that we will transmit to the higher level only a concise information, for example, the value of the feature. And we may leave the high-level analysis, the most intelligent analysis, or in the fog or in the cloud at the highest level. So basically, we can structure the infrastructure in a hierarchical way, like is shown here, with some activities performed locally on the edge of the system, and then some more analysis performed locally, leaving most of the storage and the higher level analysis to the cloud. This will allow to balance the bandwidth which is required at the various levels with the computational complexity and with the cost of this type of infrastructure. We may have also other aspects which are critical and which may recommend us to not to use the cloud, but move to other structured solution, for example, a dedicated cyber physical system. This may happen, for example, when we have very critical applications, very critical data, or when we have a very hard real-time operation, which requires to ensure that the control system acts in a very short time in order to ensure that the manufacturing process or the action we are taking in the environment, in the process, in the physical process we are observing, is applied really as soon as possible within a maximum delay with respect to the occurrence of the physical event that need to be addressed. Cloud computing and all these type of structures have been showing a significant relevance in supporting the expansion of artificial intelligence in practical applications. The cloud computing is actually a facilitator of artificial intelligence application, since it may make available larger storage, which may be needed by the artificial intelligence applications to analyze the history of the system which is observed and mapped, or we may need high performance processing, for example, to extract the actual behavior of the system from the analysis of a huge amount of data. And this type of larger storage and very performant computing architecture may be out of the typical budget of many industries or many service providers. And this is why the cloud may have been very useful to support the use of this technology. In conclusion, monitoring control systems are very critical to advance the manufacturing process, ensuring the quality of the products and the manufacturing process so that we can maintain a leading role in the global economy. On the other side, the environmental applications can benefit as well, since we can have a better analysis, a more adaptive analysis of the data, and create advanced solutions, which allow to create a sustainable environment where we can act for the benefit of the people as early as possible. Finally, I would like to point out that the monitoring and management systems based on this type of technologies are also very critical in transportation and supply chain, since they may allow to improve not only the quality, the performance of the supply chain and the transportation, but may contribute to limit the use of the energy and, as a consequence, the environmental impact that we may have. And we provide also a significant flexibility in managing transportation. In general, artificial intelligence will provide a significant increase in the adaptability of the system to the actual system we are considering. And will provide an adaptability which can learn directly from the specific data of the specific case that we are considering. And this adaptability, the ability of adjusting the behavior of the systems is more and more important. And we need to take into account that this type of technologies are actually not going to replace the workers. They can alleviate the work of people, especially for for very heavy jobs. And the people can focus on the intelligent part, on using their expertise, their skills, their knowledge, in order to increase the overall quality of the products and the environment in which we live. So I believe that introducing artificial intelligence is actually helpful, not only for the companies or the government, since the quality of the environment, the quality of the product will increase, but will be beneficial also for people and will not definitely reduce the amount of jobs that are available. In addition, it will create actually a significant amount of jobs for the digital environment that more and more is pervasive around us. And will be also a huge opportunity to create entrepreneurships in order to develop new ideas, innovative ideas, and boost the local economy, opening up the opportunities at the global level. Services may be created locally to solve a specific local problem, but actually they can grow and be used in many other geographical areas. And this is more and more important, especially nowadays, where the young generations are looking for many more opportunities around the world, in our own countries and around the world. And we need to give them the all tools, all possible knowledge that make the young generations more competitive on the global market and with the ability of improving the life of people for the benefit of the entire humanity. With this, I would like to thank you, each and every one of you, for your time, for having listened to this presentation. Thank you. Thank you for having stayed here. Really appreciate it.
Thank you, Ben, for the exciting presentation. You gave us a lot of details and in the same time, a holistic approach with a lot of experience that you earned through the 30 years of working. I'm sorry, I couldn't introduce you because I have some problem in my machine, but I want to share with the audience some slides about your bio and your efforts in many universities in Italy, USA, and your publications and your work as a chief editor and your research interests. This may help people to connect to you in the near future. I also knew that the Minister of Housing is very interested with the talk, and he sent a person, a delegate from the ministry in order to connect with you after the talk. So thank you for being with us today, and my colleague, Dr. Mustafa Al-Attar, will lead the questions and answers. Dr. Mustafa is the director of the AI program in Nile University, and he is the one who has the experience in this field. So he will be more able than me to take the questions and answers. And thank you, Ven, for being with us. And
my pleasure.
I think we have a very good friend here, and you have a lot of fans from Tunisia. We have Habib Kamoun. We have a lot of people from Gulf as well. We have a lot of people from England and Germany. So thank you all for coming. And Dr. Mustafa, please go ahead.
Hey, thanks, Dr. Ahmed, and thanks, Ven, for this a beautiful presentation covering a very important aspect, one of the important aspects, an application side for the artificial intelligence. And actually, we consider this talk as the first celebration for the kickoff of our artificial intelligence program for the undergraduates. So let me just I asked our faculty at Nile University for a set of questions. So we can start by those two questions until the other audience can prepare their questions. And I would like to ask them if they have a question, they can just raise their hand using the icon in Zoom. And then I can enable their voice so they can send their questions to you. So let me just ask the first question, which is regarding the quality control thing. As you know, quality control is a challenging topic to be applied or manifested manually by human efforts. So what is the corresponding challenges to apply at least the known artificial intelligence methodologies in quality control? That was the first question.
Well, the use of artificial intelligence in quality control need to address, first of all, the typical challenges of quality control. Obviously, since the artificial intelligence is a technique to analyze the data, exactly as we are used by applying statistical analysis, the various statistical models. the advantage of artificial intelligence with respect, for example, neural networks, to perform some of the analysis of the quality, to perform the classification of the quality of a product or the production process with respect to the statistical approaches, is that when you have a statistical approach, you need to figure out by yourself a priori which is the type of model that capture all aspects of the specific physical process you are observing. And then you apply the various statistical techniques to adjust the various parameters.
Yeah.
With, for example, the neural networks, what you can do is you just need to choose the type of model which is typical for classification or function approximation. And this is, for example, the feed-forward neural networks. And then you need you do not need a priori to choose which is the number of processing elements that you have in the model. You do not need to choose a priori to talk in terms similar to the statistical models. You do not need to choose a priori the complexity of the model. You can use a larger model, and then during learning, you can actually reduce the complexity so that you achieve a higher efficiency. But a priori, if you have enough data, you do not need to choose the complexity. So if you are not sufficiently expert in the application and in modeling, which that specific application, you can take the advantage of this kind of models in order to have an approach which is able to be configured, if you have enough data, enough significant and descriptive data. And then you have a solution which may not be efficient from the computational point of view, but from which you can start working to reduce the model and achieve a more effective solution. So this is the basic problem from the computational point of view. Of course, then you have the usual challenges for the signals coming from out of the sensor, that you may have the noise, the sensors may be damaged, may not work properly, may become faulty during time since they may age. What you can do in this case is to actually use either the statistical approaches or the artificial intelligence approaches to try to understand when the sensor is actually not working properly. And as a consequence, you can start ignoring the data coming from that sensor.
Awesome, awesome, that's great. So one of the second question that it was, from my perspective, is an important question regarding the industry of control systems. You know that they are known as attractive targets for cybersecurity threats. And of course you heard about the Twitter things that happened in the last week. So are current security solutions at the day are sufficient in case of the full integration of developed artificial intelligence system, or we cannot claim such thing at the moment?
Well, the problem is not artificial intelligence. It's that the problem is that when you put a system, a monitoring system, a control system open to the global internet, then you have the problems. If you have a system which is closed in the manufacturing company, well, you do not have ways to enter in the control system, in the monitoring system. Well, except that you may have some hacker who enter near or is nearby the company and in some way may be able to enter in the system. But if you connect, for example, the control, the computer used for control to the manufacturing system, to the sensors and actuators, and then on the other side, you connect that same computer to the network so that you may be able from home to see what is happening in the company, look to the status of the manufacturing process from home. That is wonderful, since it will allow you to do this kind of checking. But you are going over the internet. So you are opening up an opportunity to enter in the manufacturing control system. So the problem is always to make sure that whichever infrastructure we are using to implement our manufacturing control, the environmental system, monitoring system, or the transportation monitoring system, or the management of the supply chain, if we are using an infrastructure which is open to possible hackers entering in the system, since that may be part of a global internet, or there are, even if it is not in the global internet, there are points in the structure where people can actually enter. For example, you have in the company, you have the manufacturing process which is going to be connected to the computers in the administration, in the management. If someone is entering in this computer, even if this computer are not attached to the global internet, if someone is entering in these computers and from this computer is entering in the manufacturing process, you may have an attack, you may have a serious problem. So what we need to do when we are using, in general, an industrial control system or a monitoring system connected to internet or open anyway to possible connection to internet to the possible access of hackers, we need to make sure that the appropriate cyber security techniques are used in order to protect the infrastructure, both the communication and the computing computing and storing component. So that is a general problem of the infrastructure. It's not related to artificial intelligence. Of course, if you are using an artificial intelligence application, if you deploy it on the cloud or on Internet of Things, it may suffer as well from the same problem, but it will be the same if you deploy an application which is for the same purpose, which is implemented with the conventional algorithmic approaches. Nothing different. The problem is in the foundation of the infrastructure that needed to be made secure. And you need to avoid the intrusion, or even you may need to avoid not necessarily intrusion to change the behavior of the system, but you may need to prevent also intrusion for extracting data, for extracting knowledge. You need to preserve the privacy and you need to protect the data. Since if you extract data which may be private from an industry, you may steal knowledge about the processes that occur in that manufacturing process. So this may become a competitive advantage for competitors.
Of course.
And as a consequence, the investment made by an entrepreneur may be made void by this type of stealing of the data. Or you may have other type of sensible data that you do not want to disclose.
Okay, yeah. Wonderful. I totally agree. So we have actually, I would like to leave the floor for our guests to ask their questions. We have plenty of them from the Facebook page of my university and IEEE, and also here from the chat, and also there's some people are raising their hands. So I would like to start by with Professor Abdelhamid Taha from Saudi Arabia. Please go ahead if and you can ask your question.
Oh, thank you, Dr. Mustafa. Well, first of all, thank you so much, Dr. Vint, for the exciting talk and my appreciation for Nine University through Dr. Hassan and the Egypt IEEE section for hosting this talk. It's such a great event. I think my question might follow up on the last question and basically has to do with the recent push to have a more formalized explainability in AI methods, especially with regards to accountability and such. Actually, is not about the need for explainability, but how you see the relationship between that and overall system. And the second part would have to do with whether the considerations would need to change if AI is applied in different parts of a bigger system, like in multiple agents or so on.
Okay. Can you repeat the second part of the question, since there was some noise at my hand and I have not heard it completely?
Yeah, so basically, do explainability considerations change when AI is applied in different parts or in different agents?
Got it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the question. And this will allow actually to open another significant aspect concerning the use of artificial intelligence in the professional practice. Many companies are not so keen to adopt artificial intelligence in analyzing the data, in managing the manufacturing processes, since they feel that neural network, fuzzy systems, or other techniques in machine learning are kind of magic, since it is not immediately clear which is the relationship between the input and the output, how the input are actually transformed in output. In our profession, we are used actually to see the source code of a program, and we can understand which are the various actions, which are the implications of the various ramifications of the algorithm that we are writing. Or if we have a filter, a mathematical tools that we transfer in our application, we see directly, since we know the rules, the mathematical rules, we see directly which is why we are transforming and how we are transforming the input in a specific output. So we have an understanding of what's happening in the system. And this opens up the entire area of research that nowadays is very, very prolific, which is the explainability of artificial intelligence. What are these techniques actually doing on the data to generate the actual output? And this is very, very important, since this will allow to give much more confidence to the customers who are using these techniques in their manufacturing products, in their services. And on the other side, it will allow to develop toolboxes, services, components that we can sell on the web, so that the designer of a system can put together the various components based on artificial intelligence to create in a much faster way a good application, understanding what the actual components are doing, understanding how these artificial intelligence technologies are actually working in the field. And this is very important. On the other side, we have also the need of making people understanding what is happening with these technologies so that people may be more comfortable in using applications based on this technology. For example, when we have autonomous vehicles, how we can take the decisions about the various activities, especially in the case there are ethical implications. Autonomous driving, for example, maybe can be very dangerous when we, since we may have a wrong decision taken by a car, which is killing people. So in these cases, we need to understand why there was a mistake in artificial intelligence solution that created that terrible situation. In several cases, we discover actually in the past when there were some accidents of this type related to the use of autonomous vehicles, for example, it was discovered at the end of the analysis that artificial intelligence would have not been able to do anything better than real humans with the information that was provided to the tool, to the artificial intelligence tool. If you have someone who is actually jumping out between the two cars in the middle of the road, and your car is 1 meter from the person, how you can avoid to hit the person? You need to have a completely different vision, which could be feasible, but if a human was driving the car, there was no opportunity to avoid that fatality. Okay, I can have a car with a telescopic camera moving up 2-3 meters, monitoring the surrounding from a completely different point of view. But this is an augmented reality which exceeds the reality we have, the real view we have as driver when we are sitting in our car. It will be good, it will be much safer, but explainability will allow to better understand what is happening with these technologies and make people more comfortable in using them, exactly as people was used to be comfortable in using a computer, since they were able to read, or at least the experts were able to read the actual software that we have. Did I answer that to all parts of the question? Thank you.
Yes. Okay.
If I forgot anything, please.
That's clear. Ah, Dr. Tarek.
I wanted to thank Professor Puri for an outstanding lecture. It's really exciting to see some of the things that you are doing and some of the applications. I have one question, if you don't mind. I wonder, you mentioned something about agriculture and precision agriculture mm-hmm. and artificial intelligence there in measuring the soil and so on. How prevalent is it being used now in Italy, for example?
It depends on the cost of this type of technologies. I know that some experiments have been done, but I do not believe, I am not an expert of agriculture, so I cannot say exactly how much pervasive in the market is this technology, but there are many companies which are actually selling this type of solutions, and I'm talking about the bigger companies like IBM, Vodafone, or many other companies, Siemens, just to mention a few. So they have actually a market. I believe that the cost is still what is limiting the actual use of these technologies in many countries. Especially, for example, in the south part of Italy, this could become a problem since due to the type of products and the cost which is paid to the workers, since they need to find the remuneration. So adding this kind of technologies, if they help in increasing the amount of products, may be really valuable. For example, the structure of agriculture in several areas in Italy is still family-oriented, and as a consequence, the size of the land which is managed for the various products is not so huge, where you can have a significant improvement by using this type of technology when the cost is too high.
Okay, thanks for answering this question. So Dr. Ahmed Nadin, you were raising your hand. So do you have a question?
I think Professor Ahmed Sharaf Deen from Helwan, he is one of the most senior professors in artificial intelligence and computer science. Please, Dr. Ahmed, can you ask your question?
Yes, thank you very much for allowing me to ask or to raise a question concerning this very nice presentation. Do you hear me?
Yes, please.
Okay, that's fine. Typically in AI, we say, okay, it suffered from two winters, one in the early days of AI during the 1960s, and the second one was around 1980-85, something like that, when expert systems and some similar applications were, as a matter of fact, oversold at that time. My question to our professor here, do you expect a third winter to take place in the future? As a matter of fact, I asked this question for some of my colleagues and I got very different answers. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you, Professor Eldin. Well, I believe that the capability, the computational capabilities which are needed to support in an effective way these techniques, the artificial intelligence techniques, were not sufficiently available back in time in the 90s. And as a consequence, it was really difficult and painful to try to apply them in an effective way on a larger scale. Several examples have been successful examples have been shown in the literature, in the market, in the industry, but a pervasive use still required, still was not possible, since the successful cases required a significant amount of simulations, tailoring. Nowadays, I believe that many techniques are mature enough, artificial intelligence techniques are mature enough, and on the other side, I believe that the high performance computing that we have nowadays is sufficiently powerful to support this type of applications and the development of this type of applications. I'm thinking, for example, to the cost of GPUs, for example, which nowadays is much more affordable than 10, 15 years ago. And the computational power of these devices nowadays is order of magnitude what we had 10 years ago. This is why I believe that nowadays we are in a position to have the methodologies, the theoretical foundations, and we have the ability of having the computational architecture supporting this techniques. In addition, we have cloud computing, which allow to move this big computation on big data on architectures which are not affordable by many, many people, by many, many companies, by many universities, since we can buy the time and the space by cloud providers, but we cannot bring all that amount of computational capabilities and that amount of storage in our university. Is it too expensive? At least in many cases, is too expensive if we want to achieve that degree of availability. And this is why the availability of cloud computing may allow many more researchers to study in details the techniques and the possible applications, and will allow many companies to experiment the use of these techniques in their own applications. And as a consequence, as I was mentioning before, I believe that cloud computing actually is a facilitator, is an accelerator of the use of this kind of technology. Then we may need to move to a lower powerful, to a less powerful architecture. For example, we can use the cloud computing to develop a solution. And then if we have a bandwidth problem, we can move that solution, being very careful in what we are doing, we can move it down in a fog or in an edge architecture so that we can actually benefit from the ability of using the artificial intelligence solution, but we will limit the bandwidth required to bring the data from the sensor to the cloud where we have the computation. Thank you.
So we have other questions. Dr. Besant, you were raising your hand. So, okay. So maybe let me get back to some other questions that came to me in the chat.
Mm-hmm.
From just a second. Yes, this one from Dr. Walaa Madhat, she's asking, are we heading toward fog computing instead of full cloud computing, for example?
Sorry, can you repeat?
Are we heading toward fog computing instead of full cloud computing?
Oh, okay. Well, not necessarily. Since with the cloud computing, you have the complete freedom to put together the resources, storage, computing that you may need for your specific application. You can pick from the cloud the components to build an artificial intelligence-based application in an easier way. You will need actually to move to the fog or even to the edge in the case the bandwidth that you have to transfer the data from the sensor up to the cloud and the output of the cloud down to the actuator is too big and is not enough what you have in your connection, or when you need to perform a real-time analysis, a hard real-time analysis on your data. So you have a very limited time and the time must be predictable. If you have a hard real-time application, never you can exceed the maximum computing time to generate the reaction and apply the reaction to the application. Otherwise, the application is failing.
Okay.
So in these cases, you need to move down. In many cases, it's mandatory to move down to be able to be predictable with the maximum time or to address the bandwidth. Otherwise, I personally believe that staying in the cloud, you can enjoy the services, the storage, the computing at a much lower cost than having to build your own infrastructure at home. Of course, if you have security issues, privacy issues, if you have data that are critical from the point of view of the national security, you do not want to give this data out to the public in a country that for which you cannot control the security of the protection of this data.
Okay. Clear. So we have a question from Dr. Assam Rushdie. Please go ahead.
Yes. Thank you very much, Doctor. It was really a very informative lecture, and I had had a very nice time hearing from you about manufacturing and industry. But I'm a little bit greedy, and I think I would like to you to touch a little bit on some applications that are really in need of artificial intelligence, like the military, the medicine, and the weather forecasting. I think artificial intelligence is very pronounced in these applications. Can you just touch on these three applications?
Well, for the medical, we have already available many applications based on artificial intelligence. Typically, we have two different areas that are addressed by artificial in the medical field with artificial intelligence techniques. One is the creation of devices and systems for healthcare. For example, you can have very often you have in devices like the devices which are used for dialysis or the ones which are used for the respiratory support in an integrated way. For the emergency room, for the intensive care units. Many of these devices are nowadays containing artificial intelligence techniques. In many cases, they control fuzzy control systems or some analysis based on neural networks. Another type of application in the medical field is the creation of prostheses. The biological neuron connection to the prostheses, for example, is nowadays one of the very hot areas. And the control, the operation of the prostheses to facilitate the control from the human point of view. There are also, for example, for the blinds, systems which allow with the eye, for paraplegics, for tetraplegics people, there are systems which allow with the movement of the eyes actually to control the environment or even to write documents. I personally had one of my students who had a problem of this kind and was using to study computer science this kind of tools. And many of them nowadays contains two components based on artificial intelligence. I would like also to remind telemedicine. The robots for telemedicine, for surgical operations, or for remote analysis of data, of biomedical data. Many of these techniques actually embed artificial intelligence components. The other area in which artificial intelligence has been shown very, very effective for medical applications is the data analysis, the analysis of images from echography, the tomographic computerized imaging, NMR, or PET, or other techniques, in which we have a huge amount of data that we need to put together, we need to analyze, and we need to identify critical component, critical aspects which are present in the image, for example, for cancer detection or other type of applications like this. We have also other applications which are analyzing, for example, data from various type of signals, the electrocardiogram or the electroencephalogram, in order to extract some significant parameters and help the doctor, facilitate the doctor in reading huge amount of data. This is typical, for example, in several, to support the diagnosis of critical illnesses. Of course, the presence of the doctor is essential anyway. I personally believe that artificial intelligence can help, can provide a strong support, can simplify the life of the doctor so that instead of looking to 3,000 images, you can focus on the critical aspects and you can serve many more patients instead of spending a lot of time on reading images or signals. I mean, the trivial part can be done manually. The most the part which rely on the knowledge, on the expertise of the doctor, I personally believe that cannot be replaced. And this is for the medical part. And of course, to perform any type of diagnosis, nowadays there are systems in which you can put together all information, including information which is incomplete about the history, the medical history of a patient, to give a comprehensive view. Also in this case, this will be a support to the medical doctor to do the diagnosis. The advantage is that if in the literature there are histories similar to the one which has been observed, the computer can dig much easier and pick more information and present more information to the medical doctor so that the doctor can take a more informed decision. And this may happen, may be useful, especially in the countryside where the doctor may not be so familiar with some rare diseases. And this can help a lot, in addition, of course, to the telemedicine. Then, moving to the other sector, to the military sector, I believe that also in this case, there are opportunities for using artificial intelligence, since basically the military applications are based on control systems, and as a consequence, they can be used also in this case, or are decision systems, decision support systems, and also in this case, I think that there are opportunities for analyzing the data and extracting some knowledge in a faster way and provide some knowledge to the decision maker. But still, especially when there are critical applications especially involving the life of people, I always believe that the human decision is the one that must be always in the loop. Since if we have not considered some aspects, some information, in designing the artificial intelligence system-based system, the system will not be able to cope with information that was with knowledge that was not embedded in the system itself. For example, in the case of in the medical field, if I never presented an aneurysma to the system, how the system can learn that there is an aneurysma in an image? So I always believe that it is essential when critical, mission critical application, when the humans are involved and in danger, I believe that the decision of a human is always needed, exactly to be sure to have considered all aspects to the best knowledge of that human, independently from what we designed to support this decision with the artificial intelligence techniques. Did I answer to all fields?
Weather.
Oh, the weather, yes. Thank you for reminding that to me. Well, the weather is an analysis of a huge amount of data that requires a long history to be considered. And artificial intelligence has been shown effective to put together several information. Especially what I've seen useful is to use the data covering a larger geographical area and use also some local information. So that when you do a global model from a geographical area, but you have some local reference points, you can adjust the model to remove a part of the bias or the noise which may be in the data and have a more realistic model for the weather in a geographical area. Of course, it may not be easy in some geographical area to make a good prediction. For example, in Italy, due to the presence of the mountains and the sea and the structure of the land, in some cases may not be easy at all to make prediction. In some other geographical areas where you have a very flat land, well, just looking to the picture, I can do personally the prediction that the next day I will see rain in the area where I am. So
no, I had the chance to live in the Midwest, in the United States, where tornadoes were really a disaster when it happens. And absolutely. I thought artificial intelligence would be very useful in a place like this, because it happens suddenly and it's very devastating, the destruction over there. So I think artificial intelligence should be used in a place like this.
Agree, but the problem is that you need to be able to collect data,
yes,
which can be related to that phenomenon. So to make a prediction, I'm not an expert of climate prediction, but if I need to know the historical series of the atmospheric pressure in the area, and that has been shown related to the creation of a tornado, okay, I will need to have an appropriate number of sensors to measure the local pressure distributed in geographical area and monitored in real time. Artificial intelligence may be useful to look back to the history in that area and learn from the real data. In statistical time series prediction can be useful as well, if we can choose in advance the model.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Thanks a lot. So just to, because I believe that we took a bit of time, we need to just answer a question from our audience at in Facebook page. And this question from Mohammed Al-Ghazouli, he was just asking that how will the quantum computing will help the advancement of AI research development, especially addressing the cybersecurity risks and privacy threats after the evolution and changes of privacy regulations and laws in the European Union and in Egypt as well.
Well, we are talking of two different problems. One is how quantum computing can help with cybersecurity. Quantum computing, when we will have enough hardware, enough qubits in hardware, for sure will be absolutely useful to devise more complex cryptographic approaches, and as a consequence increase the protection of the data by using cryptography. But we need to reach that level. So there is still a lot of research in that direction that is needed. Quantum computing from the algorithmic point of view can be simulated on regular computers, but still it may take a significant amount of time, which may exceed the time by which we want to achieve the protection. That is a problem. Of course, we can add some quantum computing based approach to the analysis of security threat, but also in this case, the realizing it in hardware will require to wait the availability of appropriate powerful computers. From the point of view of the use of artificial intelligence in quantum computing architecture, the quantum computing architecture may help in performing in a much faster way some of the analysis and perform as a consequence the learning in a much faster way. So this may allow to deal with the time required for learning, for example, in the case of neural networks. Also in this case, the problem is we need to wait when we are going to have sufficiently powerful quantum computers in order to run this type of application. But I believe that definitely we may have some benefits in the artificial intelligence area from the quantum computing. From the quantum computer.
All right, so maybe we could have this last question from Stephen. Please go ahead, and maybe after this we can conclude our session.
Thank you very much for having me. Greetings from Ghana. I'm Stephen from Ghana, and an IT systems analyst in the University of Health and Allied Sciences, and also a PhD in computer science candidate from University of South Africa. So very interesting presentation, Prof. Thank you for for such a nice opener to AI. I want to ask from a computer science and software engineering viewpoint, and with your industry experience point of view, knowing very well that AI systems are complex in it, and we cannot afford them to fail, because we will rely on them when they can assist us and support us to do our work, being it in industry, being it in health, being in the critical mission system, like in the military, in the aircraft reservation system and stuff like that, because their failure will cause huge loss of investment to adoption organization. How will you say former methods in computing, specifically former specification, will help AI in development of intelligent systems from in software engineering point of view? Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for this question. Since it will allow me to address another aspect related to how we can integrate the artificial intelligence components into a complex system which is already used for a broad variety of applications, for example, in the industry, but in any other field. So basically, in this type of application, we have a complex system with the various components which have been already generalized, and we need to add some components to deal with aspects which are more related to the analysis of the data, the extraction of knowledge, and the support to decision making or to the control. In this case, what we need to consider is that we are not redesigning completely the application. Typically, what we need to do is to consider how we can, what we actually want to do in the complex system, what we want to do in a more effective way, in a more accurate way. Just to give you a practical example, I was showing before the laser cutting. That was a research activity that we have done many, many years ago within a European research project in which we had several big companies interested in understanding how I can do the welding or the laser cutting in a more efficient way. How I can add an analysis which allow me to certify the quality of the cut of the welding. What we have done has not been to redesign the complete control system for the laser head for the manufacturing process. For example, for the laser metal laser cutting. What we have done, we have observed the laser head. We have seen which were the sensors available in the laser head. We have extracted the same signals that the designer of the control system were using to control the behavior of the laser head. And we started asking questions to the expert of the laser processing, to the workers in the companies using this laser head. And we noticed that actually they were interested in a different analysis of the data, not for the control of the head, of the laser head, but to certify how the laser head was working in cutting or in welding. So we extracted the same signal. We moved the same signal. The company moved over the internet so that we were able to have periodic direct access to the database of this data. And we started analyzing them with neural network. In that case, we used a neural network for classifying the behavior of the welding of the cutting process. What happened is that we wrote a very simple neural network at the end. In that specific application, if I remember correctly, we had something like 20 neurons, more or less. It was not a big network. But we had the ability with that network to classify in real time the laser cutting, looking to the images. For Fiat, the Italian car maker, we did a similar experiment to weld the gear for the car, have been able to perform an analysis in 5 seconds, the time to perform the welding of the gear, and to classify each individual gear, the quality of the welding in each individual gear. We created a software component that was being added to the entire software structure to perform this analysis. So we did not revolutionize everything, but we just understood where the specific component could have been useful, and we added that. So you do not need actually to rethink the entire application and spend a huge amount of money to do this. Okay. It depends if you are able to understand which is really the problem, which is the part of the analysis that could be improved with artificial intelligence, with respect to an algorithmic or a statistical approach, a heuristic approach, and then try to work on that part so that you will preserve the investment of the company on everything else, and you are just adding the component which can make the difference in the final output. To give you an example, when we have been able to design the real-time certification of the gear for the Italian car maker, they have been able to certify gear by gear that they produced. Before that, they were using to pick 1% of the gears. They were cutting the gears, looking to the two parts to see if there were bubbles in the welded part. And if there were, they were certifying the average quality of the entire batch. With the online monitoring, they have been able to certify individually. Sometimes there are only periodic or spot defects in the production, and you may associate that poor quality to the entire batch, and you are downgrading the quality of what you produced, which means you are downgrading the possible revenues that you can get from that batch that you produce.
That's fine. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks, Stephen, for your question. Yeah. Thanks, Ben, for answering all the questions. And I would like to apologize for the other questions asked that on Facebook or here, because we already ran out of time. So I will leave the floor for Dr. Ahmed Hassan to conclude our session for today. Thanks, Ben. Please go ahead, Dr. Ahmed. Dr. Ahmed, we cannot
hear you. I would just like to thank the audience. Thank Ben for his time, for preparing this talk, especially for Egypt. We had our own requirements, so I asked him to prepare this only for us. So thank you for the preparation. Thank you for the very interesting presentation. And thank you for opening our minds to raise all these questions and to be patient to answer them all. And they defined a good book as the book that raises a lot of questions. And your webinar raises a lot of questions. And I think we enjoyed it a lot. And you were very generous to answer everything in details and in depth. So we got a very holistic view and a very panoramic view, and at the same time, a lot of details. So thank you, Ben. We wish you best of luck in your next steps. And I think you got a lot of supporters here. And we are very happy and hoping that you join us in Nile University. And we will have a good lunch or dinner. Dr. Hassan Ali will invite us. He is always the most generous one who invites us. Thank you very much for your time. And thank you all for becoming with us today. If you want to add anything, we are happy to hear you.
Well, I would like to thank you for the kind invitation, and thank you everybody for having staying with us the whole evening. Thank you. Really appreciate. And if you have any question, additional question, feel free to contact me by email. I will be happy to answer. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank again. You, Ben. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
By this, we conclude the webinar. Thank you all.
Thank you.
And see you in the next webinar. We will have a webinar next week. Dr. Tariq El-Bawab from the engineering, the Dean of the Engineering and Applied Sciences School, prepared a very good presentation with a very good speaker. So we hope that Ben will attend with us as well. And Dr. Tariq, would you like to give some glimpse about the next webinar?
Muted, yeah, Tariq.
I'm trying to unmute.
Actually, I want to thank Vin for coming here. I think we see each other in the meeting series a lot. I don't think we had a chance to talk personally, but we see each other a lot in the IEEE meeting series. And next week we'll have Ramesh. I think you know Ramesh personally. We'll talk about accreditation and ABET. He was a VP for education. He was the EAB president for some time, for two terms at least. And he will be talking about accreditation and how it has been affected by the COVID-19 crisis and how ABET is migrating all its accreditation visits to be done virtually. And this, I think, would be an interesting talk. We hope to see you next week also.
Of course, yes. Right. Thank you.
Good night.
Good night, everyone. Good night. Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay.